We have a few announcements for you real quick. On Friday, October 28th, is President Richardson's inauguration chapel, and Reverend Moore will be speaking for that. Oh, and then on Monday, October 31st, is Rachel Lemke's chapel, so please come out to that. fellowship groups are meeting at their usual time. Seekers is tomorrow, Tuesday night at 9 o'clock in Berlin Lounge. Newman Club is on Wednesday at 6 p.m. in Watto Lounge, and FCA is on Wednesday at 8:30 in the Witherspoon Rooms. Sunday, November 6th is our next wandering worship trip to Victory Christian Center in Coitsville, Ohio. We'll depart at 9:30 a.m. and should return to campus by 1:30 p.m. Transportation is provided, but space is limited, so you must sign up in the Office of Faith and Spirituality if you are interested in going. Dr. Kathy Richardson and Dr. Randy Richardson are our next Come and Meet Faculty Spotlight on Monday, November 14th at 7 p.m. in the Berlin Lounge. Come and hear as they share their life and faith story. There are still openings available for the Montreat Conference in January, and the deadline to register is November 15th. Would you please join me in prayer? O God, author and giver of all good things, plant in our hearts the love of your name, increase in us true religion, nourish us with all goodness, and bring us forth in the fruit of good works. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
Full of trouble now, I thought, how do we ever get so far down, and how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did, yeah. I created you. Now listen. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now. Well, it's time for us to do something.
Of the earth. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Sarah Smith, who is a do-something type of girl. My first impression of her when she arrived on campus was, this one is special. And you came to campus with energy and commitment, and you've continued to live it, and I really appreciate that. She's an accounting major who is committed to farming. And I know one other person in this room that fits that category. Mr. Ligo back there, and I think that you perhaps share that same love, and probably she looks to you as one of her mentors. And so Sarah and I have spent countless hours talking as we've driven across the country, and we learned all kinds of things about her. I learned that she has a love for 4-H, and I was in 4-H when I was a boy, and I can't quite consider myself a real 4-H'er because I didn't raise big animals, but I did have a grand champion rabbit once. That's a true story, by the way. I'm not making that up. But Sarah's done amazing things, and she's very committed to Habitat for Humanity. She's very committed to her faith journey. Right now, she's very committed to being one of my daughter's babysitters, and so she's gotten to meet and get to know little Johnny, who's about 4 months old now. So we thank you, and if you come up, I'll pray with you. Loving Lord, we give thanks that you have brought Sarah into our world here at Westminster. As a do-something person, she has shared her love for you with others by being involved, engaged, and challenging others by her commitment to experiencing her faith. We pray your blessings upon her. May her words today be your words. May your Holy Spirit speak through her, and may your Holy Spirit open our minds and our hearts to hear your call to us. In your Son's name we pray, amen.
Thank you. So I wanted to start with that video because we listened to it a lot while we were down there and in Guatemala, and it was just kind of reminding us why we were there and what we were doing. So you'll see some pictures behind me as I speak, but what got started was a group in Weirton, West Virginia. Their church started going to Guatemala, and they had a guy take up and be the leader of it. And my sister ended up going last year, and then she was really adamant about me going this year. And so like I got to know more about what we'd be doing down there, and so I had the amazing opportunity of going to Guatemala this past summer in June, and we were there for a week, and there were 24 of us that got to go. So while we were down there, we got to stay on the Hope of Life compound, and we got to do a lot of projects that were going on throughout the week. So we worked in the village of Altamira, which is a village that we picked to work in. And so we ended up painting the church that was built last year by our group. We held a couple of vacation Bible schools for the children in the school. When we were there, we were playing games with them. And let's just say we were very thankful for the translators that were with us down there. Even though we only had a couple, their native language is Spanish, obviously. And even my 4 years of Spanish didn't help me very much. For example, like we were hanging out with the kids, and you would say something to them, and they would figure out what you were saying, or like you could act it out pretty much. But then they would speak, and they were like, it'd be very fast, and I was like, I don't know what you just said, so hold on, let me go get a translator. So conversation was a little bit rough, but we made it. And I would say definitely
our language barrier is one of the largest struggles that we had, just because we had a lot of struggles going on during the week. We had decided to do a medical clinic while we were down there for the people to give vitamins and like parasite medication and then be able to talk to the doctor. But unfortunately, we had sent down a cargo ship of stuff because we had that much stuff in January, and it had gotten to customs in June, but they weren't releasing it because they wanted a bribe. The Guatemalan government is very corrupt, so the founder of Hope of Life, where we were staying, he was like, well, I'm not going to give them a bribe because then they'll just continue to want bribes in the future for things. So unfortunately, we didn't get our cargo ship to us in time for our medical clinic, but as you can see from the pictures, we were still able to hold one. We got supplies from the hospital, and we were able to have one of the doctors go with us so that they could speak to them and try to figure out what was going on with them. And then the medical supplies arrived the next day, actually, so we were able to sort through everything, and we got to take out more vitamins to people, because originally we had only been able to give them about 5, which, you know, doesn't last very long. So we were able to do that and then go and visit some of the sick people that were in town. But it was definitely by the grace of God that that was released during that week, because we had plans for everything that we that everyone had packed up, and we had toys and clothes and everything. So it still went to use, but just not the use that we had thought. The other struggle that we encountered was the drilling well. So the one girl from Montana, actually, she's 15, and she raised $15,000 and counting to drill a well for the village of Altamira. So their drinking water is not clean at all. They don't have access to clean water. It's basically streams of where they're getting it. It's not clean. It's often contaminated with the animals that are around. So this was the well that they were drilling, and they started before we got there, but their machines broke down and they hit 45 feet of rock. So it was a long way down. They had to drill a total of 65 feet before they actually hit a good water source that they could use. But this is the finished product. We unfortunately didn't get to see it while we were there, but we got pictures in August when it was finished. So that's on the school grounds for the kids that they can use while they're in school, because otherwise they either had to take water with them or they had to run home and get a drink and then come back to school, which obviously takes out from their education. The next pictures are the Dimitri family. So last year the group was approached by the Dimitri family, and they were in need of a new home. Obviously, these are their living conditions, and we would not consider that a home at all. It's basically sheets of metal put together and to confine what they have. And their sink is a refrigerator turned on its side. So that's just the living conditions of this village are not good. So we were able to build a house for them. It is a concrete house. It's pretty small compared to the houses that we have, but they were very grateful for the new house that they were able to have. And we also painted it while we were there. And then before we went, our leader had approached us about the sponsorship program through World Help for sponsoring a child. And it is kind of expensive. It's $35 a month. But through the sponsorship program, they get access to clean water, food, education, school supplies, medical care if they would get hurt. So this is a picture of Karen, and my sister and I decided to sponsor her in March. We've been thinking for a couple years about what we could do, because we sponsored children through our school when we were younger, and kind of decided that we wanted to do something of our own. And so this is Karen, and we actually got to see her the first day that we were in the village on Sunday during church. And as soon as we saw her, we knew it was her, and we only had one picture of her previously. So we got the translators and ended up talking to her and her family, and got to know her. And so we were able to spend the whole week with her, which was awesome, because some people didn't get to spend the whole week with them. So we ended up spending Sunday through Thursday with her. And that's actually her sister, Vanessa. which leads me into my next thing of we were talking to the family, and then she inquired about who her sponsor was because her mom had told her that she was sponsored. Well, it was actually like miscommunication, and she wasn't sponsored. She was in the sponsorship program. And so through tears on both ends, my sister and I ended up with another sponsor child, as you can see from the pictures. It was not in our plans, but it was definitely in God's plans. And so it was an interesting time, but it was a great experience. And it made me think of Proverbs 19:21, that you can make many plans, but the Lord's purpose will prevail, because it was definitely not in our plans. This was definitely an eye-opening experience to the amount of poverty that they have down there. And just like we were giving, the one day we gave out school supplies to the kids, and like when we were playing with them, we had like toys to give them and stuff. And they were very receptive and like so happy just have to one toy. But like you can think here in America, the kids would not be happy with just one toy. And they wouldn't be happy to get school supplies. That wouldn't be something that they would value. So I definitely saw the God in the village of Altamira and the hope that they have for the future. One of our struggling days was we went to a dump, and it is literally a garbage dump. And from last year, they went and there were people that were living in the dump, and that's where they lived, and they would pick out garbage to eat. And so World Help would go and feed them, and it was only 3 days. So whatever containers they had, they could take back with them, the food, but you only got so many because there were so many people that needed food. So that was a very trying day. And but this year we had heard word that they're actually moving people outside the dump, like on the surroundings of it, so that they're not living in like contaminated facilities, and that there's hope for the future for them to have like better housing. And then this is the Bible verse that is on the back of our shirts that we wore this year, and it is Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans for I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans for hope and a future. Thank you. My son would definitely be getting to interact with Vanessa and Karen. At the end of the week, they have a sponsorship like program type thing where all the sponsorship comes to the World Help. And it's, if you would go to the World Help compound, you would kind of look at it as like a vacation, because there are two pools and like it's under this big thing that where we eat dinner. But World Help's thing is work hard, play hard, and they know that at the end of the day, when it's 100 degrees outside and you worked all day and you've seen all these things, they want you to come back. And so we got to swim with her, and that was also when we didn't have a translator. So it was interesting experience talking to her and trying to like communicate and ask her about different things. The World Help sponsorship program, yeah. Yeah, it's through World Help, yeah. Yes. So our leader was the one that had set up to get all the kids into the program so that they could be sponsored. And so a lot of the kids from the village are being sponsored right now. A lot of it is from our group that had went. But we started the paperwork when we drowned there to get Vanessa in. So she is in the program. She's my sponsor child. So.
Do you pay directly to the family
or to World Help? They do it through World Help, yeah.
Yes.
Personally, the dump and just seeing the amount of people that live there, and we got to feed them actually I have pictures of that, but we got to give them food, and like just like you standing on the other side of the table from them and like only being able to give them a couple containers of food or the drink that you were giving them was that day, really far out. We were actually walking through the dump and saw one of the new trucks come in, and immediately like six people ran to it and were digging through it. And just to think about like that's their livelihood and that's what they do every day, and that some people didn't even have shoes on, and there were obviously glass and like cans and stuff, and that's what they did every day. I don't know for sure. Okay. Yeah, that was a big thing. Even we went to the church, and that's where we kind of set up everything, like the clinic was there, and the pastor's wife, they live behind it, and their bathroom is also outside their house, and they don't have clean like water through it. So when you go to the bathroom, you have to dump water into it until it flushes. So that was a different experience. Well, farming to the extent of we were outside playing with the children, and then all of a sudden everyone was like, there's cows coming, and so all these cows ran past the church, and there were men on horses leading them to wherever they were going, but everyone kind of had to watch out, and there were a couple goats and sheep running with them too, so it was interesting. Yes, that's for sure.
Would you challenge all of us to do something like this?
Yes. That's what I was actually going to say. If anyone would like to go, I know our group is going again this year. I'm not sure if it conflicts when our semester begins or not, but if anyone is interested in going in the future, I'd definitely be willing to give you information about it and encourage you to go.
Well, and if you do decide you want to do something like that, it's fairly expensive for you to do it. So you have to do some fundraising to make that happen. And I would encourage you, if you decide you're doing that, to contact our office to talk with me, because we do have some money that we can provide to help with assist you to do that. So don't allow finances to be the one thing that keeps you from going and serving in this capacity. I guess if I were to ask you one other question, it would be, and you gave me lots of examples, but where did you see and experience God during the course of your experience? Y'all may not have been able to hear her very well, but she talked about hope in the eyes of the children. And, you know, when you think of your fella and how happy he is, the happiest people in the world that I have discovered are the poorest people in the world, because their joy and the things they experience are different. Now, what goes on inside of them and behind the scenes when they go back home, I don't know, but I do know that when they're with someone who can help them have a sense of hope, they really do feel the joy. And so, thank you. Really appreciate you sharing. And as you go out, allow yourself to think about how you might do something, to go back to that opening song, how you might do something with your life beyond the occupation you have. Volunteer to go on a work trip, or volunteer to go over to the Shenango home and visit with someone. Allow your faith to be active. So go forth in peace. Rejoice in the power of God's love for you. Amen. Thanks.